Okay, I'll call the meeting to order. Department reports, first one on the agenda is the Economic Development Board. Mr. Mike James, give us his report.
Thank you. Spring calendar has been very busy. The IDA and the Southwest Virginia Regional Workforce Development Board, of which I am a member, hosted a job fair on Thursday, April the 14th at the Pennington Gap Community Center. We had about 80 job seekers and about 16 employers attend the event. To prepare the job seekers for that event, we, the week before, on Monday the 4th, we held a job fair success workshop. Had six people attend that. That's to help with everything from resume prep to interviews to helping you make your 30-second pitch to someone at a job fair. It was a real good event. We're also working with the Workforce Development Board to schedule some other events in Lee County in the near future. Have one to announce here later. Apparently I moved it to a different part of my presentation here. July the 19th, here it is. On July the 19th, we'll be hosting an information session on the new Power Grant job training initiative. So that is for displaced coal mine workers and coal supply chain workers. Whether they're miners or whether they work for a mine supply company like Joy or somebody like that, they may be eligible for free job training and tuition from Mountain Empire Community College. Regional board has hired Stephen Mullins as a new coordinator for the Power Grant program, and he'll be leading the session. So that's going to be Tuesday, July 19th, 10 a.m. at the Pennington Gap Community Center. So it's to help retrain displaced coal miners, different advanced manufacturing and IT type. There are certain certifications and trainings that you can take for that. So that's an exciting program that's coming soon. We're also working with Regional Adult Ed to schedule some classes through Plugged In Virginia. Some of you may have seen in the Kingsport paper a week or two ago, the first class just graduated in Scott County. There was eight folks, two of them were Lee Countyans. They're all going to be employed by some of the contractors at Eastman now, so we're working on a similar type program here in Lee County. It gives citizens nationally recognized certifications in the construction industry. Still working on that. So, also began exploring obtaining the certified work-ready community status for our county. We had our first meeting last week with the superintendent of schools and the DSS director. Certified work-ready community program requires a certain percentage of displaced workers, high school juniors and seniors, and current workforce members, three different categories, to obtain the National Career Readiness Certificate from ACT. It's the same folks that do the college entrance exam. Your sons get ready to graduate, or just graduated. I guess you know about the ACT and the SAT there. Over the next 5 to 10 years, we believe that most employers will begin requiring a CRC for just about any type of job. Virginia right now, there's only two counties that are certified, and there's four others that are in the process now. It's a two-year process to get certified. There aren't many employers around here right now that do require it. Sort of a chicken and egg thing. You know, do they not require it because Virginia hasn't really participated, or has Virginia not participated because some of the employers around here haven't required it? But we hope to partner with Scott County, Wise County, and the City of Norton and do it as a Lenawisco region to help with some of the expenses. It's a two-year process, and we hope to get started on it around the first of the year. Been talking to several other counties out in the eastern end of the state. Cumberland County's been very helpful, forthcoming with information. They're about halfway through the process right now. So we look forward to moving forward with that over the next several months. I just wanted to list some of the events that's been very busy in the spring, some of the events that I have attended as a representative of Lee County and the IDA. Some of you folks have attended some of these as well. We had the Coal Symposium hosted by Congressman Griffith back on April the 4th. At the TVA Economic Development Forum in Nashville, that was April 6th through the 8th. You see the board meeting in Lebanon on April 21st. Tobacco Commission work session in Abingdon on April the 26th. That was to map out their goals for the next 2 years. I had the Southwest Virginia Workforce Development Board meeting in Lebanon on May 25th. And that was the same day that the Southwest Virginia Hospital Authority meeting was in Abingdon. The Workforce Development Board meeting ran a little long. I was late getting to that second meeting. We had the VC, the Local Developers meeting on May 31st, and the VEDP, the Virginia Economic Development Partnership, had their annual meeting in Whiffle on June 1st. So we certainly had a lot of meetings all crammed together there. Then everybody tries to schedule all their meetings right before school is out for the spring, and then right after school starts back in late August and early September. In addition to all those events, I also, along with a lot of folks in this room, attended the Southwest Virginia Economic Development Forum in Wise on May the 12th. I thought it was a terrific event. Hopefully, those of you that attended, everybody got something out of it, hopefully. Whether you attended the event or not, you can still join one of the follow-up work teams to help us implement some of the actions that we brainstormed at the event. So there were several breakout sessions on different categories, from entrepreneurship to agriculture to workforce development, school systems, and you can contact Becky Joyce at UVA Wise. 276-254-0419 is her phone number, or you can go to the website. It's uvawise.edu/economic forum. So you can sign up for any of the work. Even if you weren't at the meeting, you can still help participate with some of the brainstorming sessions as we try to implement some of those ideas that we all had. So we encourage all the citizens to participate with that. We will hopefully be closing with the town of Pennington Gap on the purchase of the Patriot Center property within the next several days. With the county extension office moving next door there as well, sort of gives us a second hub of government in the county for the citizens, in addition to the one here in the courthouse area. We have a terrific relationship with the town and going to work with them on their relocation issues moving forward. We are continuing to market all of our available properties through all available channels. To that end, we have recently executed a listing agreement for the Shell Building at Constitutional Oaks with a well-known commercial real estate firm, Newmark Grubb Knight Frank. They've had two companies merge. They've just changed their name. The individual agents that are working with us, Tommy Turner and Jim Belcher, they have sold industrial properties all over Southwest Virginia, Northeast Tennessee, Southeastern Kentucky. They're very familiar with the area. So we look forward to their expertise helping us locate a buyer or a tenant for the building, hopefully very soon. Speaking of closing, we also closed on the bond financing for the county. We're very happy that Powell Valley Bank was a lender on that program. So appreciate all the folks who helped us out, particularly Mr. Poe and his office, Circuit Court Clerk and her staff, Leighton Harding, Browning Wynn, the staff at the bank, everybody that participated in that. We appreciate their help. The IDA, we also continue to feature a Spotlight Business of the Month to help shine a light on some of our locally owned businesses. Last 2 months, we've had Pizza King and Old Virginia Log Homes. So any business owner that would like to be our Spotlight Business of the Month and get some free publicity should contact my office. Louise and the Powell Valley News do a nice write-up on the Spotlight Business every month. We appreciate that. Mentioned last month that Tourism Director Mrs. Seals and I have met a few times with a potential tourism-related business. If that's going to happen, it's probably going to be next year. We've got a few hurdles we need to cross before that can happen, unfortunately. But hopefully next year on that one. Excited to see the Food City Gas and Go under construction after some permitting delays. There was a little bit of confusion when construction began there initially. But the county, the town, and the IDA have all participated in that project, so we're glad to see that going. Black Diamond Market on the western end of Jonesville is also under construction as well. So look forward to those businesses opening later this summer. IDA also approved a loan from its Small Business Lending Fund for a new business in Pennington Gap called Long Hollow Sales, LLC. They'll be doing hydrographic printing on the former pawn shop building next door to the IGA. So we wish them success. Still waiting on the results of our grant application. We had applied for $100,000 from USDA to be used for small business lending. So we're coming to the end of the second quarter. The announcement will be any day. It may spill over into the first few days of July, but expecting that announcement any day. We're optimistic on that. We got some good feedback from the administrator in Richmond, made a few tweaks to our application. So we're hopeful that we will get approved for that.
Do you have something that's already foreseen that goes to, or is it kind of a lot?
Yeah, it would replenish our small business lending fund, basically. So after the loan to Long Hollow, we'll have about $6,000 in there. So we want to replenish that and loan it out as many places as we can. You know, the larger loans we've made from the Economic Development Fund, which Board of Supervisors and the IDA manage jointly, but we've had to separate a smaller fund as well for small businesses. So, but no, we don't have it earmarked for any particular business. No, just you know, any budding entrepreneur or existing entrepreneur, whoever. So we're happy to help anyone. Encourage everyone to check our Facebook page regularly, as we do post updates, jobs from the Virginia Employment Commission, as well as other relevant news. Planning and zoning wise, so far we have issued 49 zoning permits this quarter. If it sounds like a lot, it is a lot, that we only issued 19 permits in the first quarter. So the Appalachia Service Project has kicked off their summer program. They've got a lot of, you know, renovations and new roofs and handicap ramps, things like that going on. We also have a group of almost 200 folks from the Richmond area Archdiocese. They're in town this week repairing homes, building handicap ramps as well. So they account for the majority of the large increase in permits. I know the Archdiocese of Richmond has 16 homes they're working on this week and may spill over into the weekend. So those folks are staying at the high school. So we thank ASP for their continued work in the county and welcome the folks from Richmond to town as well. I've had Kathy and Keith Herring, the building inspector, and myself had several conversations with those guys, and they're real friendly, good folks, and we welcome them to town. They're doing they have 16 homes here, and I think six in Wise County that they're going to be repairing. So
these guys, are they young?
Yeah, the most of the volunteers are, yeah, teenagers or college age, yeah. And then with we were dealing with sort of the group leaders. They were, you know, adults, but yeah, most of it's like ASP, it's young folks mostly, so. You see a extremely high number of teenagers running around this week. That's what's going on. So ASP has their first group in, and then the Archdiocese from Richmond is here as well. Planning Commission has completed the first phase of the zoning ordinance and subdivision ordinance update. Probably go to public hearing on that in a couple months, maybe early fall. Beginning in August, the Planning Commission will start tackling the zoning map for a periodic review using commonly issued variances as a starting point. We started this once before. At that time, the Commissioner of Revenue's office was in the middle of some updates of some maps and things like that, so we waited for them to finish. It makes it a lot easier for us now that they are finished, so we appreciate their work on that. We're going to begin that again, probably be a 12-month process or so. Planning Commission has been working very hard, and I appreciate their efforts. Current Planning Commission members are Mike Brendel, Donnie Brooks, Joyce Williams, Greg Rasnick, and Reba Nelson. I've also visited 16 properties to address zoning concerns. Again, several of those were done on behalf of the Richmond Archdiocese project. We have a lot of the older homes in the county. Some of you're going to build on a handicap ramp. They don't meet zoning requirements. You know, a lot of these old houses are right on the road, you know, and we're trying to find a way to make the zoning work without having to go through variances and things like that. We've got all of them but one resolved at this point. So that's all I have. Be happy to answer any questions.
Back to the Constitutional Oaks. You said that's going to be advertised for a tentative or for sale. What is the asking price for that place?
Well, as is, we're going to list it at $995,000. So that was the suggestion of the real estate firm. We'd actually had it originally listed a little bit lower. They encouraged us to increase that a little bit, so we did. Of course, quite frankly, selling it as is for that price is unlikely. You know, most companies will want, they'll have to build it out, and they'll want us to finance the build out, and you know, for them, that's the most likely way when and if someone arrives that it will happen. But we would love to sell it as is. That would be our preferred method. Anyone else?
Sounds like you've been busy. You did a good job, man.
Spring's been very
appreciate
busy.
Appreciate your
definitely. Efforts. All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Second is Ashley Seals. She's not here tonight. Apparently, she had to go to the funeral. but we do have two other people that we added to this list, and one is Dr. Sue Antrow, Lewisville Health District. Would you please come forward?
Good evening. Thank you for allowing me a few minutes to speak, and it will be briefer because I've had it all in PowerPoint and didn't bring a hard copy, so I'm going to try to do it from memory. I did prepare for you a couple of handouts. The first, I wanted to cover three topics kind of quickly. The first is Zika virus infection, and the first handout I'm going to refer to is this blue one here. Zika virus, as you've heard in the news, is a mosquito-transmitted virus infection. It was actually originally identified in 1947 in the Zika forest in Africa, but there's another strain of it that's from Southeast Asia that's actually the one that's responsible for most of the cases in South America and Central America and the birth defects that you've heard about. It's transmitted to people by mosquito bites, and the form of mosquito is called Aedes aegypti and Aedes albopictus. And why I'm here is Aedes albopictus mosquito is the most common mosquito we have in Virginia and the most common we have here. So that's the mosquito actually that we, implicated, that was implicated in some cases of lacrosse encephalitis that children had back 10 or 12 years ago. So that's a daytime biting mosquito. It's the one that aggravates you, biting your ankles and knees when you're outside during the day. And it is the most common nuisance mosquito that we have in Virginia, and it's capable of transmitting this infection. Right now, there's what's called local transmission, meaning infected mosquitoes biting people and causing disease in American territories, Puerto Rico and the U.S. Virgin Islands and Hawaii and American Samoa. But so far in the 50 states of this country, there hasn't been local transmission. But there have been over 700 cases in Americans in the United States who traveled to an area where there was local transmission, to a cruise to the Caribbean, or in our area, what we're seeing a lot of this time of year are mission trips. A lot of people go on church mission trips to Central America and South America, which is wonderful work, but they're at risk of being bitten by mosquitoes and infected with Zika and then coming home with that infection. And then once you get home, the counseling that we're doing to people who I do a lot of foreign travel consults before they go, is to tell them to be sure and use their mosquito repellent and all the measures that you're supposed to use that are on the back of this second page. Just flip it over, about wearing long sleeve shirts and staying in places with air conditioning, a lot of the mission work, of course that's not available, but using the appropriate insect repellent, using mosquito nets and things like that. But the real message to them is people who acquire Zika, only about 20% of them have any of those symptoms that you see there on the front, the conjunctivitis, the rash, the joint aches, and the fever. 1 in 5 will have that. 4 out of 5 people who get Zika infection have no symptoms. So we're counseling people who are coming back, who are going on mission trips, to do everything they can to avoid mosquito bites while they're in Central America and South America and on trips, but also for 3 weeks when they get home. Because when they come back to this country, if they're one of those people who are a little sick or who have no symptoms, and our mosquitoes, local mosquitoes, albopictus, bite them, they can infect their local mosquitoes. And mosquitoes, only female mosquitoes bite, and they bite before they lay eggs, and they bite about every 3 days, and they live anywhere from 4 to 8 weeks. So they're going to bite a lot of times. So if they bite someone who's infected, and then the next people that they bite, weren't infected, they can become infected. And so what we're concerned about is having people who are at risk, who are entering the area, who've been traveling to an area where there's transmission, to take as good a precautions to avoid mosquito bites after they get home for 3 weeks as they hopefully did while they were traveling. Because again, a whole lot of them won't have any symptoms. Most of them won't have any symptoms. Of course, you may have also heard that two other things that can be transmitted through intimate relationships between men and women. Men tend to carry the virus longer than women, and so men with symptoms of Zika, when they come back, if they shouldn't be intimate with someone for 6 months, if they're trying to get pregnant, nobody knows how long exactly it lasts. But for 3 weeks if you have no symptoms, and 3 weeks if you're female, if you're male, it's 6 months if you had symptoms. Or use barrier contraceptions. The other thing is regarding the mosquitoes, one of the big things we do, in addition to counseling people who are traveling, is if we have someone who returns and we think they have symptoms of Zika, we can arrange for them to be tested. There's a couple of commercial labs in the United States that do one particular test for Zika virus, and so doctors can order that, or they can come to the health department or call the health department if they are concerned about someone who may have been exposed or who has symptoms, has traveled to an area, and we can arrange for testing if they meet criteria. It goes to the state lab, and there's no charge for that, and we've reached out to all the providers in the area. They should be familiar with how to do that. So we're glad to do that and can arrange to have the testing done. You've heard about the risk of Zika virus infection to pregnant women. It's becoming a little more evident that it's early pregnancy that's the greatest risk. On the back of this first page, too, are the pictures of the babies with microcephaly. That seems to be a greater risk when the mom is infected during the first 3 months of the pregnancy, but they're still not saying that it's safe at any time. So the baby is born with a smaller skull and a smaller resultant brain inside of it and significant lifelong disabilities. So getting this infection if you're pregnant is devastating, really. And then the other complication that's been well documented in this country, even among the 700 people who come back from other countries with Zika, there have been cases of Guillain-Barré syndrome. You may remember Guillain-Barré from swine flu vaccine back in the 80s, I think it was. But it's where it's a progressive paralysis, really. And those people end up with paralysis, kind of usually starts in your fingers and toes and works its way up to even involving the muscles that help you breathe. So those people often will end up in intensive care on a ventilator. They typically get better, but it gets better very slowly. So they can spend weeks or months in the hospital on ventilators and rehab. They've seen three cases of that so far in the people who contracted Zika from foreign countries and have returned to the U.S., but South America's seen a lot of it. So that's a risk to non-pregnant people who get Zika. So that's why we're concerned about it. We have the mosquito, we have people traveling, and we want to make people aware of the risk and also what they can do to eliminate the risk or to reduce it. Eliminate it by not going to places where there's travel, but if you're going, then there are those other steps about reducing your mosquito bite risk. On the other handout is how to control mosquitoes that spread dengue fever, chikungunya, and Zika. So there's different mosquitoes out there. Those great old big ones that sit on your door are West Nile carrying. These are smaller ones that just, like I said, they kind of fly around your legs and ankles when you're outside. Those are the ones that carry dengue, chikungunya, and Zika. But Zika is the one. Dengue and chikungunya don't have the effects on pregnant women or the Guillain-Barré that are being seen with Zika. They breathe in containers. So puddles, ponds are not where Aedes albopictus and Aedes aegypti breed. They breed in containers. So little tox toys were the worst thing we have seen when we go into yards. Those, just any little dip that'll hold a teaspoonful of water, these mosquitoes will breed in. So flower pots, we've talked before about the saucer under the flower pot. They love that. What they'll do is they'll lay eggs in the flower pot, and then it may not rain or you may not water the plant again for 4 or 5 days, but the next time you wet it, those eggs, when they're moistened, will hatch out, and the larva forms will develop, and it can go from an egg to an adult in as short as 3 days. So if it stays wet long enough, then even if the eggs have been there for weeks, if they get wet again, they can hatch. Guttering that needs to be cleaned out, tires, junk laying around the yard, those are just wonderful places for this to breed, for the mosquito to breed. The public health response to this and what we'll be doing is if we have a call about a potential travel associated case that of somebody who's traveled to a country where there's risk of transmission, we will interview that person and probably or possibly do a home visit, talk to them about, look around their house for potential mosquito breeding sites so we can eliminate them if possible, and then talk to them about mosquito transmission, reducing their risk of letting mosquitoes bite them while they're sick. So that's the first travel associated one. If there's a case that looks like it might be what is called local transmission, where somebody got it locally, and they don't have a history of travel, they don't have a history of a partner that's traveled or any link to foreign countries where it may have been acquired, then we'll definitely make a home visit, educate them about their risk of transmitting it by allowing mosquitoes to eat on them, and also looking at the mosquito habitat around their home and eliminate, for about 150 yards from where they live. It's usually, these mosquitoes will fly 150 to 200 yards from where they hatch. So they don't fly half a mile or anything. So that's the area we're looking at. And at that point, if there are a lot of mosquitoes visualized there, then some adulticide spraying can help with that. But big community spraying, because of the way this particular mosquito breeds in small containers, it's just not all that effective. Larvaciding you can do if you have tires out and you can't, you can't get rid of them, you can't move them inside, or you can't cover them. There are some larvicides that you can buy that you put in there in a tire about once a month, and it will kill the larval stage of the mosquito and keep it from developing into an adult. So there are some ways to kill the mosquito even at the larva stage or adult spraying, but community widespread fogging like you see in some parts of Virginia. There are, I think, about 11 or 12 counties in Virginia that have official mosquito control programs, but they're mostly in Northern Virginia and over around the beach, so none in Southwest Virginia, although mosquito control does fall to local government according to the state code. In this case, we talked to citizens about source reduction, meaning going through their neighborhoods and looking for areas where there are lots of containers that could breed, and we have some handouts and some door hangers that we can put on doorknobs of homes or make available to you. Where people can just once a week, pick a day that they'll go out and tip over their toys and tip over their ornamental yard stuff that they don't want to get rid of. Ideally, they cover it and get rid of it, and clean up their yards. But it really takes a pretty intensive community effort to do that. But it's something that we would encourage before to try to minimize the number of mosquitoes and therefore reduce the risk. And then finally, if we get us two cases of local transmission that don't seem to be related to each other, then that would be a significant finding, and we'd really come back to you and talk about some real organized source reduction efforts in the community. But I would encourage you to consider doing that now. One of the places I know I've looked at before, and it wasn't in this county, the cemeteries are pretty good breeding grounds for mosquitoes because of all the flower bases, some of them built into the monuments. So looking at how residential areas that may be residing within a couple hundred yards of graveyards or any other place, tire places where the tires are left out, are going to be places that may be potentially a risk to residents that live near there. Okay, so I think that pretty much, there is the Virginia Municipal League and the Virginia Association of Counties. I don't know if you got an announcement. They're having a 45-minute phone call next week that they've organized. Dane, you've been invited, and maybe perhaps some of the other board members to be on that phone call, just talking about local mosquito control efforts that are being undertaken in parts of the state and maybe something to consider for you. The other thing I wanted to mention or bring to your attention today was, which is unrelated to Zika, so if you wanted to stop for a minute and see if you have any questions about Zika and mosquitoes. The third page of the handouts there are the 2016 county health rankings, which are put out by the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation and the Medical College or the University of Wisconsin. They look at health factors and health outcomes. Health outcomes in their website, which is just countyhealthrankings.org, really are a picture of today's health, and then health factors are some of the both social determinants of health, social and economic conditions, as well as health behaviors and clinical care that impact our health for the future. And on the sheet that you have there, I've just summarized the rankings for Lee, Scott, Wise, Norton, and Virginia for comparison. So the actual county health rankings start about a third of the way down the sheet there where it says health outcomes. The ranking this year is, they ranked 134 jurisdictions in Virginia, so those ranking numbers that you see there are out of 134. So you can, as you read down the list there, you can kind of get a picture of our challenges in the area. And we've just completed a community needs assessment for the Southwest Virginia Health Authority. And then I met with a group of Lee County citizens and Scott and Wise and Norton just to take what the authority had done and said, you know, does this make sense for Lee County, and are these the priorities for Lee County, and what do we want to work on? And I was really pleased that a number of people were participated in that, and many of the same priorities, particularly around substance use and substance abuse and the complications that we've seen related to that, as well as some of the obesity-related chronic diseases, diabetes, overweight obesity, and physical inactivity, and tobacco use were pretty much the top priorities that the group has selected and that we'll be moving forward and trying to look for funding and begin to address. I will say that regarding the substance use and substance abuse issues, there was a county in Indiana, Scott County, Indiana, that in 2014 and 15 was in the news quite a bit, especially in 15, because of its rate of HIV infection that was related to IV drug use. And it was a rural county, very much like, it was north of Louisville, but it was, you know, largely Caucasian, high rates of unemployment, and just had a lot of IV drug use in that community. Among usually the drug they were using there was Opana, and they were injecting it. And they'd had a hepatitis C outbreak a couple years before. And then in 2015, they saw, normally that county had reported two or three or no more than five cases of HIV in a year. And in 2015 through March of 2016, they've had 190 new cases. And they were all linked to IV drug use. CDC looked at all the counties in the country, and they identified factors in Scott County, Indiana, that they were able to pinpoint as contributing, or they came up with a definition of what they called a vulnerable county, which had factors that were similar to the factors that were present in Scott County, Indiana. And there were 220 that looked at their rates of drug overdoses, and looked at their hepatitis C rates, and looked at their employment levels and educational levels. And in Virginia, there were 8 counties that fell into that 220 counties. And they were Lee and Wise and Dickinson, Tazewell, Russell, Buchanan, Wythe County, and Patrick County. And so all they're saying is they don't know where or if there'll ever be another Scott County, Indiana. But if you look at some of the factors that they felt like were kind of warning signs that there was some risk there, that these 220 counties had some of those same warning signs. So we've been working very hard. We have seen an increase in hepatitis C here, and we have seen an increase in acute hepatitis B again in 2015, not just in Lee County, but in Lenawisco. And we aggressively try to contact those, even though that's not a requirement of the CDC or the state of Virginia. We try to identify the source of the risk factors that the acute case has and their contacts, so that we can get to the contacts and give them vaccine to prevent hepatitis B, and get them into treatment for substance use, refer them for treatment if they're willing. One of the things that we've been surprised a little bit and disappointed a little bit are the number of people who are actively using who are not ready to go to treatment. And that's really concerning, to the point where there is a medication that they can take that you take it once a day if you're IV drug using and you're not ready to get into treatment, and it reduces the risk of them getting HIV infection if they're exposed to it. That's something we're pursuing with the state to see if that drug could be available and we could prescribe it to. The preference, of course, would be for those people to get into treatment, but it's hard to force somebody to make that decision. So we want to try to protect them and their family members and their household contacts by reducing their risk. So that's where we're standing with the substance use and what we're doing from a public health perspective to address the substance use. And we also have implemented and have a high-risk pregnancy case management nurse that's helping try to reduce. We also have the highest rate in Lenawisco in the state of neonatal abstinence syndrome. That's babies born dependent on medications that go through withdrawal. And so we've been working really hard to try to identify those mothers and get them into treatment and try to reduce their rates of NAS to try to improve the outcomes for the baby and for the family. So those are sobering statistics and sobering information, I think, but I think it's really important for you to be aware of what was going on here and the efforts that are being undertaken to try to reduce the harm to the people who were involved in that, as well as to their family and contacts in the community. Any questions?
Great information. Thank you.
I can send you the PowerPoint today, and if you want to share it, I mean, if you're interested in seeing the maps and the slides with the numbers, I'll be glad to do that.
Yeah. And,
okay, I'll do that. Thank you very much for your support.
Thank you.
Okay, I think Donna Stanley is here from Behavioral Health.
Good evening. Thank you for having me. I will be brief. I don't want to bore you. I'm a financial person, so numbers is my game. And that's what I'm here to just share what we do. I think most of y'all are familiar with us, and following up on Dr. Cantrell, you know, we provide, you know, mental health, intellectual disability, and substance use services for Lee, Wise, Scott, and the city of Norton. And we've got our annual report, and it just highlights some of the services that we have provided. And I want to just point out a couple of things. A new program that became available was the Governor's Assistance Program, GAP. I'm not sure if y'all are familiar with that, but it allowed us to serve an additional 150 people that were severely mentally ill through the Governor's Program. And services are continuing to grow, but the need is continuing to grow. We had served last year 5,628 individuals, but it's estimated that there is 92,924 people living in our area that have behavioral health conditions. So we still have a lot of people that we need to reach. And I just want to point out that, as I've said before when I've come before you, we do provide a number of jobs in the community, which we all know is very needed in this time. We provided 221 jobs. And with the ripple effect of that, it's a total of 256 jobs. There's a total labor income of $8,290,496 that we put into the community through our programs. And all of this is in the annual report, and we did a little snapshot for you all to look at, just to look at, you know, what we do, and at your leisure, read our annual report. We continue to grow. There continues to be additional funding and additional grants that we seek to try to provide more services to the individuals in our service area that are in need. We have a lot of different programs and a lot of different needs out there. I'll answer any questions that you all have if I can.
Like I said, I'm brief. But I do thank you. And we want to do this every year. We want to come. We go into all of the Board of Supervisors. And, you know, just so you all will, you know that your local funding does help support us and the services that we provide. We appreciate the funding that you all give us each year. And we thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Constitutional Office, we have the Treasury report that you can take a look at. Public Expression is next. Okay.
I'm Roger Elkins. I'm here tonight on behalf of the Daniel Boone Soil and Water Conservation District, and I'd like to hand you a little bit of information, and then I'm sorry, I will try to talk a little louder. I just wanted to, at the last meeting, Mr. Cope had asked about some additional information on the acid mine drainage program, and we talked about and had some information on that. And I apologize for not getting this together so that it appeared in your board packets. But this is just a synopsis of those projects that we talked about. The four that were recently completed are on the first couple of pages that you have there. The third page back is just a little bit of a chronological history of the program and what we've done over the past few years. And then the last page is a map showing the location of the work. And so we just wanted to follow up. I promised him that I would follow up with some additional information, and so we just wanted to get that together for you and provide that for you to this information.
Okay.
So that's what I have.
You guys working on any presentation?
Currently, there is not any underway that I'm aware of. It's between funding, and at this point, because of funding issues, I think DMME has kind of put this kind of thing on hold until they identify what, how they want to move forward. This is a project that we work in cooperation with DCR and DMME from a funding standpoint. We just kind of administer. So, if you'll notice, some of those sites on there, some of them have already been completed, some of them are proposed. I really can't speak to which ones are which, but just an overview of the program. Thank you.
Anybody else? Okay, close the floor for public expression. Next is approval of our minutes. Everybody take a look at the minutes if you haven't already, and I'll entertain a motion for approval of minutes for the May 17th public hearing, May 17th regular meeting, the May 26th recess meeting, and the June 2nd recess meeting. Favor? Meet none. In an objection, the minutes are approved. Okay, the county administrator reports that the payroll warrants have been issued. Okay, you have the approval of disbursements. You hear a motion to approve?
Make a motion.
Second? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?
Who was the second?
Any opposed? None being, so the approval of disbursements. Supplemental applications. That's number five.
Supplemental appropriation.
All up together?
Yes.
Do I hear a second?
A second.
All in favor? Any opposed? No. Okay, the supplemental appropriations have been approved. Okay, now new business board appointments. Okay, Lonesome Pine Regional Library.
I make a motion we appoint Roberta Smallwood to that position.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, Ms. Smallwood is appointed. Mountain Empire Community College. I have nobody yet. I move that we hold this until next time, until we talk to somebody, unless somebody has somebody.
I have somebody.
You do?
Yeah, that's something they asked me about if they were interested, so.
Okay.
Make a motion to appoint Stacy Step Muncie on the Mountain Empire Community College Board. Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All right. And the other appointments are for July. Okay. New business.
Mr. Chairman, the next item there is the Dryden Fire Department Emergency Medical Approval. Last month, a representative of the fire department requested the board's consideration and approval for them to establish rescue services in addition to fire. The enclosed resolution provides that authorization for them to provide emergency medical services in the county. This is required in order for them to proceed with establishing the agency and obtaining state certification. That's resolution 16-020.
Make a motion that we approve.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries.
The next item is the rural rustic designation of projects on the six-year plan. At the May meeting, we held a public hearing and eventually adopted the six-year secondary road plan. At that time, VDOT representatives explained that the roads on the plan need to be designated as rural rustic in order to complete the projects at a lower cost, and they gave you some information on the rural rustic program. They don't do an extensive amount of work. They clean up the grading, but the right-of-way they use is a little bit less, just a little less intrusive, and so they can get the project done at a lower cost. There are resolutions enclosed for seven projects, all that are currently on the plan, as each one of those was entered into the plan and proposed as a rural rustic road. They needed a separate resolution on each one instead of putting them all on a single resolution. You can adopt them in mass, that there won't be a problem with that. It's resolutions 16-013 through 16-019. And I did include in there some information. One of the first projects, the project that's coming up first for construction is 656, which is Old Friendship Road. And the portion that's to be paved is a mile of that road. That road's probably about 2.5 miles long. The first mile from the Sugar Run side is the portion that will be constructed first. So about approximately 1 mile from 659 back to the south is the portion that would be constructed. And there, VDOT is prepared to begin that basically in late August or early September. Now, after the last meeting, I guess when it came out in the newspaper, I was contacted by a property owner on 656 about the paving of the road and some concerns. They indicated that several people were opposed to paving the road. Because they felt like traffic was going to increase and it would be safety issues and traffic was going to be driving faster. I advised that the project had moved, it had moved to the top of the list and was ready to be done, and that if they were opposed and they needed to provide documentation that there was opposition to this and that it was people who lived along the road. Since that time, I have received signed affidavits from four individuals requesting that the road not be paved. I did include a copy of those in your packet. Two of those individuals are husband and wife. They own property on that route, but they do not live along that route. The other two individuals, based on 911 addresses, they live on that route, but not on the portion that is scheduled to be paved. They live on a different part of the roadway, so have not received any opposition from residents who live on the portion of the road that's scheduled to be paved. But I just wanted to make you aware of that. But
where would you run into issues on the approvals of taking the property and having to widen the road? And
no, on the rural rustic.
Fall into
on the rural rustic, they'll work within the existing right of way. I don't think there'll be any issues where they would actually look for additional right of way other than what they already have. That's one of the purposes of the rural rustic.
Yeah, just the surface street.
Right. And I say that's about a 2.5 mile long road. I won't say that traffic won't increase, but is only, is going to be less than half of it that's paved, and so I don't see a lot of people, a lot of increased traffic cutting over to Sugar Run, opting for that road when they can do the same thing on Campground Road, which is paved from one side to the other. It's fully paved all the way through, so I would think that if people are using the shortcut through, they're going to use the road that's paved all the way. But that's just my opinion. I mean, I don't know what people might do.
So you feel like it's okay to go ahead with it?
Well, it's ready to go. If it's not, then you're scrapping what VDOT has been planning for about 5 years as that road, actually longer than that, as that road moved up in the process. And again, I've had four affidavits, one of them husband and wife, and again, they do not live on that road. They're property owners, they do not live on that road, but only two property owners on the entire stretch of 2.5 miles, and there's a lot of other residents.
There's a lot of people on that.
Who have not responded.
No, there's not a lot of people live on that road.
No, there's not a tremendous amount.
It's pretty.
Do those folks understand that that's not going to be paved where they own the property or live?
At the time that lady called, I didn't know exactly where. I didn't have time during our conversation to pull it up. I looked it up after the fact. But I have not talked to any of the other three individuals about it.
I think it's people that would have the road paved by their house would appreciate it because of not having the dust issue.
How many total folks live along that?
I don't have the exact number of houses. I'll have to pull that up.
Where they're going to pave it.
There's probably about six on that end where it's going to be paved.
And those are the six that are not opposed?
No one on that portion has submitted anything in opposition.
Well, I make a motion we adopt resolution 16-013 through 16-018 to move forward with a 6-year plan.
19.
Left one out.
19.
Yeah. 013 through 19. I'll second that.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries.
The next item has to do with the Corps of Engineers agreement for the Western Lee Sewer Project. There's a copy of a proposed agreement with the Army Corps of Engineers for that project, which requires a commitment for a 25% local match from the local sponsor. The overall project is expected to cost approximately $11 million, with the initial phase consisting of design services. Those are expected, this first slug is about $350,000. The Lenawisco Planning District Commission will provide the local sponsor match for design services. Of course, the local match for project construction is anticipated to come from several sources: the Virginia Tobacco Commission, ARC, possible block grant, and other possible funding sources. Construction is not expected to begin until at least 2018 or after. And in order to move the project forward, though, and allow the Corps to begin design of the system, this agreement needs to be approved. The Western Lee Sewer Project is a very much needed project in order to further development in that portion of the county. In dealing with Corps of Engineers, you take small steps at a time. They do not get, in other words, they do not have this $11 million all in hand at this time. They have a commitment for that over the next several years. And so they're sort of spoon-fed the project spoon-fed by their funds, and you provide the match as their funds become available. So this is the first phase of design, and in order to get them started, we would need to approve this agreement and become the local sponsor.
And it took some time to get to this point.
Yes.
Yes.
I'll make the motion to approve this.
I second the motion. All in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries.
The next item is a memorandum of understanding with the Daniel Boone Soil and Water Conservation Office. Since July 1 of 2014, the Daniel Boone Soil and Water Office has administered the county's erosion and sediment control program. Their Board of Directors has requested that a written agreement be in place for this. So I've enclosed a proposed memorandum of understanding that they drafted to designate the obligations of each party for their continued administration of this program on behalf of the county. There are no set financial commitments in there, just that we'll work together each year to provide funding to them and review the amount of work that's being done and things of that nature. But it does just set out the basic obligations of each party in this process. Something that's been being done for the past 2 years, they just wanted basically to reduce this to writing and have an agreement in place. Is that correct?
That's correct.
All right.
Is there, was there an issue or something that come up, or is this more of a...
We, and I want to recognize Bobby Burchett, he's here tonight. He's the chairman of our budget committee. And just recently, during some of our budgetary committee meetings, you know, we were looking at our budget request to come to you folks for consideration. We appreciate that. And when we got into that process, we realized that we had had this agreement and we were working together with the county, but we didn't have anything formal. We didn't have anything in writing. And so we just thought it would be a good thing to put together a memorandum of understanding, just so that, you know, the obligations of both the district and the county were just kind of spelled out. And I think Dana's assessed it correctly. They're very general things, no specifics on money, no specifics on this, just that we'll review this agreement. We'll talk about what the financial needs are, the obligations are, how the program's going. If we need to make changes, then we'll mutually agree to change it.
And I think we discussed doing this at the beginning, but at that time, we were under a mandate to also, they were going to take on the stormwater management program, which the state was forcing down our throats, basically, for us to administer. And the emphasis was on just getting that program up and going and all the training. Fortunately, sometime after that, during the next legislative session, the General Assembly saw fit to provide an opt-out for rural counties that wanted to and allow the state to continue to implement that program. So we just never did get around to preparing this MOU for just the E&S programs.
Right. I think the intent all along was, I mean, we were back and forth as entities talking about what we would and would not do, and we kind of came to that agreement with the intent formalizing it, and then somehow it just kind of never got done right because of some different forces.
Right.
Thank you. I'll make a motion to accept the memorandum of understanding with Daniel Boone Soil and Water.
I'll second.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Thank you all very much.
Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Item F, new transfer station pay request number 13. You have a copy of Green Construction Company pay request number 13 in your packet in the amount of $80,425.77. That's for work completed during the past month on construction of the new transfer station. I have received, since this was sent out, I put a note in your packet that I did not have the architect's approval of it, but I have since received that. I actually got it late that day when the board packet went out, or early the next day. So the architect has recommended payment. He has no issues with any of the pay items, and I would concur in that.
I make a motion we approve pay request number 13. Green Construction Company. Second.
All in favor?
How much you like on that thing?
They're close. They're getting very close, but there's still some things being done. I haven't been able to get over there. We actually have a progress meeting Thursday of this week. I'll know a little bit more Thursday night, but in talking with Gary, most everything's moving along pretty rapidly. It's just, you know, zipping everything up at this point, getting some of the pavings started, things like that. So we're not going to be in by July 1, but Gary wants to hold off until they can get the office space done. He's getting materials together and everything for that to get ready to start moving as quick as possible. He wants to, when they move up there, he wants to have the office staff, everybody on site, so that he's not down in the office remote, you know, quite a few feet away. He wants to be able to be up there, because it's going to be a little bit of learning curve for everybody to learn to use the new facility. So hopefully by the 1st of August, we'll be in there. Next item, this has been discussed previously, but the establishment of a public school capital reserve fund. It's been discussed, and I think there was agreement to do this, it just was not formalized, and that's what we're doing or requesting at this time. There are two documents in your packet for consideration on creating a public schools capital reserve fund. This would be used to finance needed school facility improvements. The first document in your packet, and it was actually left out, but we mailed that to you after the fact, is a resolution which creates the fund. Ms. Muncy and I both did some research on it. There was no statutory authority in state code authorizing us to do this by ordinance, so we'd simply do it by resolution to create it. The second document are guidelines for the source and use of funds. They're fairly simple. As you'll see, the school board is in agreement that any year-end savings in their budget would be split into two pots. One-third of that savings would revert to the county's general fund. Two-thirds of the savings would be deposited into this capital reserve fund, and the Board of Supervisors would be free to contribute to the fund additional funds if they deem it appropriate. As needs are determined by the school board in conjunction with their capital improvement plan, they would submit requests for specific projects to the Board of Supervisors, at which time you would decide whether to approve and appropriate the funds. And this, the capital reserve fund is just like any other. You cannot spend the money until it is appropriated. So it would require legal appropriation from the board anytime funds were spent. This, in essence, then gives the Board of Supervisors final approval of projects funded by these monies. So if you have any questions on the guidelines or the resolution, feel free to ask.
So basically, that's two clauses in. One, say the 33% that they was giving back, if we decide to put it in there, we can, even cap on top of it.
Yes.
If we won't. And they've got to come with us with something such as a roof for central office or something like that, and that's where the funds actually.
Yes, they would bring specific projects that are in line with the capital improvement plan that they adopt.
And so they can't dispend that money?
No, not until it's appropriated.
This is all just basically what we all already have agreed on.
What has already been agreed to and discussed in the past.
I'll make a motion we accept the establishment of public schools capital reserve fund.
I'll second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Item H, Gary Collinsworth, the superintendent of the transfer station, has requested that the board authorize purchase of a new bush hog mower. The old mower, even though it's only 5 or 6 years old, it's in rough shape. The frame is breaking up. They've welded it. It's actually, the metal's been cut due to damage. The stump jumper has already been replaced once and has been welded several times. Some of the damage was actually due to very rough terrain that has since been corrected. When they first bought this machine, those of you that have been up there to the transfer station, the area behind and up on the hill behind the central garage, that area was covered with trees. It was the grading was terrible. It was a shame how it had been done over the years, but when they used the bush hog initially to mow and do a lot of work over there, it did suffer a lot of damage because of that, because they couldn't see where they were going and what they were getting into. Since that time, over the past 3 years, we have regraded that entire area to get better drainage and improve our gas monitoring program. We've also done quite a bit of fill and grading out on the last landfill sale that was filled. We had a lot of subsidence out there a couple of years ago, and they spent the entire summer basically hauling dirt and filling that in and cleaning a lot of areas up. So a lot of that is probably not going to be subject to as much damage in the future, but the damage that's been done to it's already there.
So you're saying you use the bush hog for grade work?
Pretty much. Yeah.
That's a lawnmower one.
He's requesting to replace this 7-foot unit with a new 10-foot mower that would provide some time savings in the mowing that they do. This is also, they use this machine some at the airport. We've got another machine that they can use at the airport that it's the wing type that folds out, that mows. But this would also speed up the mowing operations over there and some of the other rough areas that we use it for down at the airport. He's also recommending that a tongue-style pull-type unit be used and rented instead of the type that mounts directly to the three-point hitch on the tractor, because he says that's causing additional strain on the tractor itself, that the pull-type would be less stressful on the tractor.
Does he have a picture of that in there?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, I see it now.
He's obtained quotes on four different brands from four vendors, and the prices that are listed there, Lady Equipment is a 10-foot house, spelled H-O-W-S-E brand mower at $5,640. Green's Trailer and Equipment priced both a Bush Hog brand and a Tennessee River brand mower at $7,850 and $4,950 respectively. Lawson Building Supply priced a Bush Hog brand and a Land Pride brand at $99.50 and $86.50 respectively. And Cox Tractor priced a 10-foot Bush Hog brand at $77.95. After reviewing all the mowers, Gary went to the dealerships personally to look at these machines. He's recommending the 10-foot house from Lady Equipment based on the thickness of the metal and what he sees as the construction of the machines.
So he does think that this thing will hold up, this house.
Yes.
Never heard of this brand.
I hadn't either, but that's...
I know a little bit about Bush Hog, and that's not a good Bush Hog.
Okay.
That's what I'm thinking too.
No, I of course I buy from Lawson's. That's what they're right there at the house. I buy them.
The Bush Hog brand.
Yeah, that's right. That's the real deal.
Well, we've got the Bush Hog brand price from three different vendors there too. So,
I would go,
if I was buying one, I would buy this Cox Tractor Bush Hog brand. I wouldn't buy nothing else but Bush Hog. I had a John Deere brand and it lasted me about 2 years.
I've had both of them, got both of them. I've got the Bush Hog brand and I've got that Land Pride I bought too. I've got down there at Lawson's also. But anyway, this top mower up here that you're talking about, that it'll be wore out.
Yeah. At Tennessee River brand mower, we have no idea. It looks like a cheap motor mower thing. Discussion.
Is that as close as our local supplier would match?
That's the price they gave us.
10 versus 10.
So why did he decide to go with that one, Diane? I mean,
pardon?
Why did he decide to go with
it? He was looking at the metal thickness and some things like that. But again, people who use them, you know, day in and day out with no mower. I mean, that's just a portion of what they do over there. So it's not a piece of machinery that he's, you know, uses a lot themselves over there or has a lot of experience with one way or the other. He was just looking at the machines themselves as far as what he saw was construction and metal thickness. But,
well, and he's probably looked at it. That's the money savings.
Yeah, I think he's looking at trying to hold the price down.
Yeah, but I appreciate that.
Yeah. There's a Tennessee River brand for 40, give me a license, 49. But Lord, I never heard of that.
No.
No, I've seen them, but it's junk.
Well, I don't like Cox Tractors. Got the best price on the Bush Hog brand.
Well, I sure would like to buy a local. I'd like probably
I would too. I see the difference in the price there. I would. I'd like to buy local with the building supply down home in Lawson's, and I do see the difference in the price. I really do understand that too. But I would like to buy local, but I also understand. The land pride bush hog there at Lawson sells. I have one of those also. And they're a tough bush hog. They come up front with a 3-year warranty on everything about it.
It's still $1,000 a month.
But yes, it is. I understand.
I understand.
I just like to stay local, but I do understand.
We're going to meet again.
2 days.
In 2 days. There's one thing I do see on the quotes. These are not sealed bids. These are just quotes that they gave us. The Cox Tractor states a 2110 bush hog, 10 foot. The Lawson Building states bush hog brand 10 foot, 3210. Now, I don't know whether there's two different models there.
Is it something we can check into?
Well, that's what I'm going to say. We can check this between now and Thursday and just clarify that they're expecting the same machine. The same model.
So I think you need to contact both of them.
Right.
Then you guys compare.
Right. So let us just get a little bit more information on that.
Well, what green quote there? I didn't look at that.
I don't think there's says one way or the other.
Bush hog green, it's 7850. Oh, the kind.
It says a 2010. It's the same as well, it says 2010. Whereas Cox says 2110, so right. Got three different model numbers that's being listed there.
Is that green? Is that the same company over Sneevil?
That's Sneevil.
Yes. I've dealt with them too.
So let us clarify those models and make sure we're comparing apples to apples.
Okay. Good. All right.
Well, do we need to make a motion to table it to our Thursday meeting?
If you want to do that, that's fine.
I'd make a motion until we do some further, evaluate it a little further.
I'll second that motion. All in favor of tabling it?
Aye.
Okay, we'll table it then. Okay. Yeah, I guess we're down to a report from our county attorney. She's not here. So we go back to the county administrator and see if he has any.
I've had one item I didn't get on the agenda and three that came in actually yesterday. So there's nothing significant. Had a refund request since we had no other refunds on the agenda. I just held this till my reports, and it's a very small refund, but I hate to hold it till next month. Say refund request from the Commissioner of Revenue's office for Winston Turry, $11.73. He was assessed and taxed for a larger acreage than what he actually owned, so they were correcting that.
You got another one?
No, that's the only refund request that there is.
Motion to approve refund to Winston Turry for $11.73.
Here a second?
Second.
All in favor of the refund?
Aye.
Okay,
the next one, and I'll rather pass this across, I'll just highlight it. As I indicated last Wednesday when we talked about waiving the tipping fee, that there could be others.
Yeah.
Got a call yesterday, Mark Swecker, who, he's an architect actually with Thompson & Litton, but he's also president, I think he said, of the Habitat for Humanity Agency in Wise County. He's working with the Southwest Virginia Long-Term Recovery Coalition to identify damages to the homes last, in the winter storm last year. And they have some groups coming in, as the Mr. James said, they've done some zoning permits for different groups that are coming in to help with some of those repairs. He called yesterday about a specific project they were going to do this week. It's a roof on a house, and they wanted to know if the county would waive the tipping fee on the debris that would come in from that. And I told him, I said, well, put it in writing and send it to me. Yesterday he said one home, and this one he does not specify. He just says the coalition requests that the board consider at their next regular meeting allowing those authorized by the coalition to dispose of construction debris generated by repairs to Lee County homes in the county landfill without the encumbrance of any fee. It is estimated that debris will weigh no more than 1 ton per home repaired. So he, I thought he was talking about one house yesterday. Now he's sort of opened that up as an open thing. There's not a lot. I think on the list that we had, we're looking at the potential actually for a block grant application, urgent need block grant application for some of these home repairs. We had a list, the group that had, the Recovery Coalition was working on this, had a, probably about 15 to 20 homes on this list, but we've gone through and updated some of that, what's qualified and what's not. Some of it was porches and garages, and block grants cannot be used for those, has to be for damage to the primary house home itself. So we've narrowed that list down. Three or four of those homes that were on the list are going to be addressed with this group, the groups that are coming in over the next 2 weeks. And a couple of the others, the homeowners would not respond to the coalition staff that were trying to contact them. So the housing authority has picked up on this. There are probably going to be 5 to 8 projects that could potentially be done. And we were looking at those. If we can put a project together, we'll be bringing those back. Next month at the July meeting, we'll have a project-specific public hearing for that project, potentially. This doesn't affect our cap for block grants. It doesn't fall under that, but there's a limited amount of funding available each year under the urgent need program. I think it's capped at $1 million statewide. So far this year, I don't think anyone has applied. Wise County's putting together an application now. It's probably going to run around $600,000. The initial estimates that the coalition group provided us had very low estimates, and they were only estimating materials, no labor or anything like that. So three of the homes were considered probably candidates for full replacement, because if you use state block grant funds, if the home requires, you know, fairly extensive work to bring it up to code. If you do any work on the house with block grant funds, you have to bring it up to code on a lot of other levels. You can't just, you know, put a new roof on and quit at that. You have to look at plumbing, you have to look at other issues. So three of them were probably going to qualify as full replacements, and the coalition was proposing buying a single wide mobile home. The Department of Housing and Community Development will not allow that. They won't stick built replacement housing if you do that. So I talked with Mr. Knapper this afternoon. Three of the projects, like I said, if this proceeds, could be pretty extensive. One may even require relocation because the existing house is in the flood zone. So we'll know more about that next month. But that's where some of this work is being generated, these groups that are coming in. Some of it is that. So here's another group that's asking for waiver of tipping fees, at least on one specific house that they're doing this week, but he's also looks like opening the door for a few others if they have some that the coalition authorizes.
The agreement we had last time, what was it, up to $200?
Yes.
Yeah, that was it was by case also.
They were doing 27 homes.
Yeah, 26 or 27 homes.
27 homes, yeah. It was like $9 a home that we was given a break on, and they actually had the estimated tonnage and plus we said case by case on what was, you know, if they want something waived, they need to put something in that's a little more specific.
I agree with you.
As to, you know, they might have as much tonnage as all 27 of them homes doing one house, one project.
Well, he was saying on this particular one that he talked to me about Friday, that it was one, he expected, it's a roof. It's a roof on a house. He was expecting it would probably run no more than a ton.
$9 a ton?
What it is?
We charge $37.50 a ton.
$7.50 a ton.
Whatever the other one was, we figured.
The other one, they were saying they thought they would probably have between 5 and 8 ton. And I said, at the max, it was probably going to run $250.
Yeah. So that's what I'm saying, but we give a break of like $10 a house.
Right.
You know, to help with some of the, especially them bringing 200 people.
Well, not all of their projects will generate waste that has to be, some of it will just be repaired.
Some of it will be probably wheelchair ramps.
Right.
And stuff like that.
Yeah.
But I think on, you know, case by case basis.
I think if you've got people coming in here willing to help these folks, that we need to help them too.
That's what we did last week.
I mean, with these others too.
Well, yeah. You know,
we don't want to hold them up while they're here. I mean, they're only going to be here so long, right?
Yeah, this one is to be done this week, the one he's talking about.
Well, when we done the math, it was what, like $1,700 a year?
That's what ASP, that's
but I think
what ASP's bill is running.
I think it still should
we
be.
We haven't waived anything for them.
Case by case on, you know, on the project.
So, well, like I say, I know they've got one house that they're going to do this week. That's the only one he mentioned to me.
Well, so, case by case, who's going to, they're going to be doing this work. And
you'd be meeting a lot.
Yeah, we're going to be meeting a lot.
What I told, I mean, I had another, Alan on his way to the meeting the other day, sent me a text and said, well, the Lions Club was going to do a little project. Four members of the Lions Club. I said, look, unless they get prior approval, I do not have authorization to waive the fees. I'm not asking for it, man. But I said, I don't have that authorization. They need to plan this in advance. You don't come in and just ask for it and get it granted by a department head. That's not going to fly because we've never done that in the past.
No, we're just trying to, like I said last time, you got 200 people coming in and helping 27 homes, and we give them a $200 break. I mean, it's like a dollar per person.
Right.
You know,
we didn't go overboard.
No, we didn't. I mean, that's what I'm saying. We, you know, we have that on some. And
well, all the groups, in reality, all the groups will probably should be helped from this anyway. I mean, with what we talked about the other day, up to a certain point anyway.
And I think we could, and I still think it ought to be, and no, we don't need to have extra meetings. They can submit it as it comes through. But, I mean, they still need to be a little fairly specific on how many homes they're assisting, what the estimated tonnage is.
Well, Gary will need to have some guidelines on how much the charge should be. Well, we need to come up with.
Well, I mean, on the one you did the other day, you gave them a waiver of up to $200.
$200.
What I explained to the gentleman was, their waste will go in over there and be invoiced just, you know, like it would normally. When we bring the invoices over here and get, or when we bring the way bills over here and get ready to invoice it out, we'll allow the $200 credit at that point in time. If they don't go over that, you know, it'll all be waived. If they do go over that, we'll bill them for the difference.
So are we thinking something along that line with these?
But again, when we talked Friday, what he talked to me about was one house, one roof. And it was to be done this week. That was the only one he had discussed with me. And I don't know whether he just did this in general. I really don't know why he phrased it that way. But he says, we're beginning to make great headway with repairs of these homes, with many more. Of course, he's talking about Lee. He's talking about all of Southwest Virginia, Buchanan, Dixon, Lee, Russell, Scott, Wise, in the city of Norton. But he says, we're beginning to make great headway with the repairs of these homes, with many more repairs to be made this summer. As with any home repair project similar to those we are experiencing, primarily roofing, these projects will result in construction debris that must be properly disposed of in a landfill, which he had the county landfill. We don't have a county landfill. But he said, we request Board of Supervisors consider allowing those authorized by the coalition to dispose of construction debris. That was the portion we didn't talk about. He talked to me about one project. He didn't say, we may have several projects down the road. You know, again, I'm like you. I think there needs to be some specific amounts.
Well, they were very specific.
But I know of the one project that he did specify that they did plan to complete this week.
I believe, Dave, we just need to know how many they're going to do.
Okay, I can get back with you, and we'll find out Thursday. If you don't, we're going to have to pay for it anyway. We'll deal with it that way. But I'll get back with you on it.
What happened? He left that way open.
Well, like I said, he...
I mean, that's pretty much saying from now through the eons of time.
He sent this last night at 9 o'clock, so I saw it when I came in today.
He must have found out we had a meeting this evening.
I told him Friday we had a meeting today.
Well, he waited
till 11 o'clock. But he had to be here before then. Another item, the IDA, we have a loan that was made to them last year at this time. Late June for $50,000. It was a 1-year line of credit loan, and it is coming due. Discussed this with Mr. James. They do not have sufficient funds to pay that off, and are therefore requesting a 1-year extension on that at this time.
What is the interest rate we settled on for this?
I think it's zero interest. Yeah, it's a zero interest loan.
Oh, it was?
Yes.
I think I wanted to charge interest and nobody else did.
Mr. Poe, what does he need the line of credit $50,000 for?
Well, this was a loan that was made to them in order for them to make some repayments on some existing obligations that they had. I don't remember if this one was tobacco commission driven or something else, but it wasn't something that they used just to spend money on, you know, operating or anything in general. It was to make a repayment on a set repayment schedule to another entity.
How many of these exist?
We've done the 50, I don't have that full file with me. We did this one, and we did one back in February. I think it was in February.
Was that one 50,000 also?
Yes.
Yes.
So
there's 100,000 out
total. 100,000.
Yes.
Uh-huh. And then there's only two that you're aware of?
Yes.
So I guess we have to do this.
They don't have much of a choice now. They don't have the funds to pay it.
Well, I'll make a motion that we allow them to extend this note.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
And the last item, we took bids on the flagpole at Ewing Elementary School. We got one bid, $25, from Jerry Brown and Ewing.
He was overdue.
That's probably $24 too much, right?
And it's his responsibility to take it down. So if you want to accept the bid, I'll need a motion to do so.
Was that all we got?
That was it.
Well, it's worth more than a scrap metal than that.
No, metal's way down.
You got to go cut it down.
I wouldn't take it.
I believe I'd make that motion to accept that bid.
Second.
Okay, all in favor?
I know it's his problem, but tell you the truth, I wonder how he's going to take that pole down. Because that thing, that's pretty thin. That ain't one of these heavy metal things. And if you drop it, it'll
If he can get something attached to the top of it to steady it, and then take it loose at the bottom, he can probably lay it over there.
What is he going to do with it?
Sentimental thing.
Put it in his basement.
No, he's going to put it out there in the front yard. They took a big tree down, and he's going to put it out there.
my cousin Richard, he gets up every morning, puts a flag up, and then in the evening, he goes up there and takes it back.
Yeah. That's all I have, other than we will, it had previously been decided to meet in recess on Thursday, the 23rd, for, and at that meeting, we'll be looking at basically three or four items, the budget adoption, including appropriation of the budget.
Okay.
And payment of year-end bills. And I don't know if Sharon will have any additional supplemental appropriations or cleanups to do, but possibly some transfers or something like that within existing funds in the budget, but we may have some of that as well.
What time is it?
It's up to you all. Y'all had talked about 6 o'clock.
I thought that's what time we said.
6.
But, I mean, you set that at this meeting.
Okay, and that's the
23rd.
Thursday, what is it, 23rd?
Yes.
All right. Okay, reports from the board. Robert, you got anything?
I have, Mr. Chairman.
You do?
I do.
Okay, Nathan, you got anything?
I met with the fire and rescue in Pinkton Fire Department last night. We had about a 3-hour meeting, and I spoke with Dane today. We may look at actually trying to put together a group or a committee and look at some of these services, fire, rescue, sheriff, dispatch, 911. I'm gonna get together with Mr. Bailey and talk to him and then try to set up some time. I can, once we get into exactly stuff, maybe we can line out, then maybe bring the board into more involvement. So I just want to kind of let everybody know what's going on.
Okay, anything else?
No, sir.
Okay, I got nothing except for going home.
Go wear a journal.
I
don't have anything.
Oh, here.
DD?
No, I don't have anything.
All right. Then we can go home. Meeting is adjourned.
Oh, we need a motion to recess.
Well, I just made it in a second.
Okay.
Okay. Okay, motion to adjourn.
Recess.
Recess until Thursday.
I'll second.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Now.